Okay, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. And now I'm presenting you a multi-scale geomatic approach to analyze and to characterize some features in the archaeological site. In particular, this approach, we will see the use of the very high resolution multispectral data came from satellite images to analyze the archaeological site at small scale, and then we will see some application at little scale, a large scale using UAV and terrestrial photogrammetry. So the analysis has been focused on one site test, that is Alba Fucens colony. It is a Latin colony in the central Italy, and it is the largest archaeological area of the Apennines. So we start with some application with the use of very high resolution multispectral data. In particular, we use WorldView 2 multispectral image to analyze some characteristics, some features. The character images are characterized by an AIG. We have two images, a panchromatic image characterized by an AIG geometric resolution that is equal to 0.46 meters, and a multispectral image that contain 8 spectral band. These band are located in the electromagnetic spectrum in the visible range, some in the visible range, one in the ultraviolet range, and two in the near infrared range. So to use the multispectral image in a quantitative way, so metrically, we need to perform some preprocessing step, in particular the orthorectification. In this slide, you can see the application of the rational polynomial function, the RCP, to orthorectify the image. In addition, we use some ground control point to improve the orthorectification output and some control points to evaluate the quality of the orthorectification. After that, another process is interesting, pre-process is interesting to take advantages from the use of simultaneously of the panchromatic and the multispectral image. This step is the fast sharpening process, and it allows to merge the high resolution geometric resolution of the panchromatic image with the high spectral resolution of the multispectral image. So we obtain a fast sharpening image with the high geometric resolution and the 8 bands. After that, we can process the image, and there are different analysis that will be performed for the archaeological sites. One of these, as Professoressa Donatella Dominici introduced first, is the use of NDVI. The NDVI is the normalized difference vegetation index. It is a normalized difference between the near band and the red band. It is used often to detect and study vegetation. And why the vegetation has an high reflectance in the near band and a low reflectance in the red band. So if we have high value of NDVI, we have a healthy green vegetation, and if we have low NDVI value, we have a stressed vegetation. This is important in the archaeological sites because if we have a buried structure below the vegetation, it's possible the vegetation up is a stressed vegetation, so we expect low value of NDVI. Here you can see the application of the NDVI index to the Alba Fuchs archaeological sites. We investigate the different areas in red, and here we have the zoom of this area. The use of NDVI is correlated also to the shape of the value of the NDVI. So if there is a varied structures, we have particular geometry, particular shape and geometry. Another application to analyze the varied structure is the use of the PCA, the Principal Component Analysis, a statistical method that allows to shrink redundant data into fewer bands. And in this picture, you can see the application of the Alba Fuchs sites, and also we highlight some particular structures that can be varied structures. We shared this varied structure with this hypothesis with the manager of the archaeological site, and they confirm that the presence of varied structures. So another processing useful in the archaeological sites, it's the classification. Classification means grouping similar pixel value in a group, in groups that identify a specific category within the data. And the pixels are divided into categories based on their spectral properties. We have two classical approach, the unsupervised classification and the supervised classification. The unsupervised, some automatic algorithm produce spectral classes based on the natural grouping of multiband reflectance value. Instead, the supervised classification, the process of classification is supervised by the operator. The operator chose the classes, the different classes called trained areas, and then in function of the training areas, the classification is performed. Here you can see the results of the supervised classification in the case study in the Alba Fuchs site archaeological site, sorry. And we create different classes. Here there are the classes of the area. And the output of this results is a thematic map. And another, the next application that we will see used another type of image, very similar to the Worldview 2, but because they are the panchromatic image, the images are the same geometric resolution, but the difference is in the spectral resolution. In particular, the GOI1 has only three bands in the visible range, red, green, and blue, and one band in the near range. Here, the application of high pass filter on the GOI image, the GOI1 image. In particular, the high pass filter maintains only the high frequencies on the signal and allows to highlight the differences in intensity between the pixels and reducing the background details. Here we are in the
Maria, 5 minutes.
Yeah, sorry. Okay. We are in the south part of the Alba Fuchs area, and the high pass filter highlights some particular features that we analyze with in situ campaign, and we have found that there are defensive structures and wall structures. The same X-pass filter was applied also in the World View 2 image, and in this case, inside the archaeological areas, in the amphitheaters areas, and here we found different signal, different traces of wolf path. These wolf paths are very important because they can produce problem of soil erosion. So in this case we survey this area in detail using the UAV photogrammetry. So we acquire some photograms with an adequate overlap for the photogrammetry process with a GSD equal to 1 centimeter, and then we okay, here we have the results of the photogrammetric process, and we use the DSM, the digital surface model, to analyze the geometrical information of these wolf paths. Here we apply some morphological analysis in GIS environment. With the same data acquired by UAP photogrammetry, we analyze also the structure inside the archaeological site of Alba Fuchs. In particular, the amphitheater, we reconstruct the wall structures with the definition of the architectonical elements and their dimensions. Moreover, from the dimensions, we estimate also the maximum capacity of people that contain. With the orthomosaics came from by the UAV photogrammetry, we analyzed the decay forms inside the wall of the archaeological the amphitheaters. In particular, we defined different decay forms, and we highlight in the orthomosaics. So we can the use of the orthomosaics is useful to quantify these decay forms. This work in this way, in this case, we manually detected these decay forms, but in the future works, so we won't try to apply an automatic way to detect the forms. In this picture, you can see another area of the Alba Fuchs site, a portion of wall in the northeast area, and also in this case, we analyzed the decay forms in the area, but and not only from the not only from the profile from the DSM, we analyze some profiles to analyze the stability of the walls. Finally, all this information acquired with different sensors can be useful to create a unique geographical informative systems, not only to the knowledge of the archaeological sites, but also to monitor and manage the complex archaeological areas with the aims of conservation and safeguard of this important heritage. Thank you very much for the attention.
Okay, thank you, Maria, thank you. Now, Sara,
Yes.
with spectral analysis, it's okay? It's possible, the demo software, Sara?
Yes, I hope the connection will hold, and we can do that. If Maria,
We cross the finger.
Yes, me too.
Okay.
Um,
Go to presentation.
Let's try. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. So, good morning to everybody. I'm Sara Zollini.
Mi scusi, sono il tecnico. Yes. Dunque, noi continuiamo a vedere soltanto la finestra del desktop. Dovrebbe cortesemente condividere tutto lo schermo, non l'applicazione, quando preme il tastino schermo.
Ah, ok, ok. Now?
Un attimo sta... Ecco, adesso vediamo la presentazione. Perfetto.
Yes. Sì, ok.
Ok, so again, a good morning. Thanks to everybody. We are going to see how to process spectral data. And in particular, we are going to see a new sensor that was launched at 2019, but it started to collect images in 2020. And his name is Prisma, which is an hyperspectral sensor. The hyperspectral sensors are really useful in determining the chemical physical composition of the objects to be detected because they have a really high spectral resolution. And some analysis that we are going to see, we can extract the spectral signatures of the materials on ground. The spectral signatures are the identity card of the detected objects. And so we can understand the composition and the materials on ground. About Prisma, it can acquire two different cubes, the Vinir cube ranging from 400 and 1000 nanometers and collect 66 spectral bands, and Swir cube from 940 nanometers to 2500, acquiring 173 spectral bands. So in total, it has more or less 240 spectral bands. So the resolution, the spectral resolution is 14 nanometers, but it also has a spatial resolution in the panchromatic of 5 meters and in the multispectral 30 meters. And it has also a temporal resolution of 29 days. The Prisma products are provided into two levels. The first level is top of atmosphere. It means that no atmospheric correction has been applied yet, and they are the raw data. Then we have the level two products that are divided into three sub-level, L2B, L2C, and L2D. We are going to see the L2D product, which is like an L2C, which contain vapor, water vapor, aerosol, and the cloud characterization maps. But it contains also a UTM projection. It means that it has it was georeferenced. As you already saw from the previous PowerPoints, every images, especially satellite images, need to be pre-processed. In the case of hyperspectral images, one of the most common pre-processing steps is the removal of the bad bands. The bad bands are the bands which contain pixel with no data. It means that we have no information in some pixel, maybe due to atmospheric water absorption, or maybe due to low signal to noise ratio, or for error patches. This step is really crucial because the use of these bands can lead to a low accuracy of the results. So here there is an example that you can see of a bad band. So the red points are the pixels which contain no data. And if we are going to analyze the histogram, which is a graph that contains in the x-axis the digital number, and in the y-axis the frequency with digital number is present within the image. And as you can see, on the right, there is an example of the histogram of a good band, which has a regular and uniform shape without any peaks or anomalies. Instead, on the left, you can see an example of a bad band histogram that has most of the pixels, the digital number, close to zero, and it doesn't have a uniform, regular shape. So this is one of the main processes that we need to perform, especially in hyperspectral bands. So doing that, we are going to remove the bad bands from the analysis. So we are going to... Sorry? No, okay. So we are going to apply a spectral subset, like a spectral subset. So here a brief presentation of what we hopefully we are going to see in the practical session. We used the ERDAS imaging software to analyze the Prisma data. ERDAS has a special tool for Prisma data analysis, and the images has an extension of HE5, and when we import the images inside the software, the software will create a 8 product in the format, a panchromatic image, the two cubes separately, so the Wiener cube and the Swirl cube, many error matrices, and then a raster which contain all the 234 bands sorted according to the wavelength. The first two bands have been eliminated from the Swirl cube and the last three from the Wiener cube because these five bands are corrupted in the current version of Prisma products. So the tool does it in an automatic way. Then we are going to perform the band evaluation. So after that, we choose a file, which the TIFF file of the total image, which contains the Wiener and Swirl cube. We can select the map boundaries if we don't want to analyze all the images but just a part of the image. Of course, this step can be performed also before insert the image, give as input the image, and then we can export a TXT file that we can import in spreadsheets like Excel, for example, and we can see the number of the bands and how many node data contain each bands. But we are going to see this in the practical session. So after that, we can create a subset, a geometric subset, a spatial subset, in order to cut the area of interest to remove the unnecessary information and so reduce the computational work. So after the pre-processing, there is a tool in ERDAS Imaging that is a workstation called the Spectral Analysis, Hyperspectral Analysis Workstation, in which we can apply the pre-processing steps. So at first we can add information about the sensor, which means that we share the bands number. We link the bands number with the respective reflectance values, with the wavelengths, sorry. Then we can edit the bad bands. So after the analysis on the which are the bad bands, we can give this information inside this tool. And then we can apply the spectral subset and the spatial subset. We could also apply the atmospheric correction and the minimum noise fraction. But in this case, we are using L2D products that have been already corrected from this point of view. And then the workstation allows to process in many different ways. What we are going to see is the spectral signatures processing to analyze the different materials in the archaeological site of Alba Fucens. So at first, the image is open inside the spectral workstation. Then the sensor information tool allows to insert the respective wavelength according to each band. So we can obtain a plot in the end with the correct wavelength range. Then here we are going to see this practically also. Here there is the bad band selection. So you can see the image on the left, the relative histogram, And all the bands sorted according to the wavelength, and we can check which one of these is a bad band according to the TXT file that we generated before in the steps before. And so we are going to analyze which one are the bad bands, and you can see this information inside the graph where there are the red stripes. So after that, after the preprocessing, the image is ready to be analyzed. And what we did in the is to analyze the spectral signatures of characteristics of soil. Can you hear me? Sorry.
The signal is has some noise, Sara. The Wi-Fi would be a problem, probably.
Now it is okay.
Now it's okay. Okay. So I was saying that pits, rocks, and soils were the spectral signatures of pits, rocks, and soils are extracted. And the spectral signatures of Prisma were compared to the Sentinel-2 spectral signatures in order to validate the data. The spectral signature contains in the x-axis the wavelength and in the y-axis the reflectance values. So these are the results of the alpha fusion spectral signatures. And each graph contains the spectral signatures from Prisma and from Sentinel-2. This is the pits, the green one is the pits, the red is the rock, and then we have light soil, dark soil, and alpha fusion soil. At first, we can see that there is a full agreement between the spectral signatures of Prisma and Sentinel-2 data. Of course, thanks to the high spectral resolution of Prisma data, it is possible to see the windows that you can see here around 1,300 to 1,400, and also at 1,800 to 1,900 nanometers, you can see the windows of the atmospheric absorption. Of course, we cannot
Sara,
see this.
Sara. It's supposed 15 to 10 minutes for real time software. It's possible to see.
Yes, yes.
Processing.
Yes. Okay. I'm almost finished this. Okay.
Okay.
So what we did after is to analyze the spectral signatures of each element, materials inside the alpha fusion area. And we saw that the detailed knowledge of territorial context allowed to undoubtedly attribute the spectral signatures of the pits, which is the green light, the light green signature, to calcium carbonate. And this well matches with all the spectral libraries related to calcite. And the area, in fact, is well known for important extractive activities of high quality carbonatic gravels and concrete mixing. Then comparing pits and the soil, light soil, both the green lines, it's possible to observe that in the veneer data, we have almost a good overlapping between the two signatures, but we can see a big difference in this weird cube, maybe because the light soils are rich in calcite responsible for their hue. The rock instead is the red line and is between the pits and the dark soil because they are covered with the vegetation that lowers the spectral response. And we can also see that the alpha fusion soil is closer to the dark soil, maybe due to the major presence of organic materials. So to conclude this part, we can summarize what we have said, that the bad bands analysis is strictly required in order to delay those bands which contain no data and are not useful for the test. The spectral signatures of alpha fusion site acquired by Prisma and Sentinel-2 show a full agreement among them, but of course Prisma has a higher spectral resolution, so it provides more details. Then the spectral analysis shows that it's possible to obtain important archaeological information regarding the soil and constituent materials. And then hyperspectral data allow to compare the known and unknown areas for inspection and cognitive evaluations. So I concluded this part. Now I try to show you the software, how the software works. But I have to connect in the computer in the laboratory in Italy. I hope that you can see.
Yes.
Okay. So can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. So as I told you before, this is Erdas imaging. And here we have the Prisma tool, in which you can see the tool to import the data, and the tool to make the band evaluation. So if we click here, you can see that here you can add the information of the path, where is the folder of the product that we are going to analyze. And here in the second blank space, we can add the name with this extension, that is HE5, with of the image that we are going to process. So after that, after including these two information, we can click on run. And I show you what the product that I already generated, because it takes a while. So laboratory. Okay, so the input data is the HE5 file, and then 8 products, the TIF ones, are generated automatically by the software. So we have the 4 mask error matrices, the panchromatic, the 2 cube veneer and sweer, and the reflectance veneer sweer, which contain both the cubes together. So after that, we can choose one of these. We have chosen this one, the one that contains both the cubes together, and the image can be analyzed. So at first, we create a subset in order to reduce the computational work. And to create a subset, we can go here in a raster tool, in which there is another tool called the subset and chip, and the create subset image. Here you can put the input file, you can choose it from the folder, the right folder. You can put where the image, the subsetted images will be stored, so the output file. And here you can put the coordinates of the area of interest that you can put manually or otherwise from an inquiry box. After that, so we produced a subset in TIFF format. The subset, I already opened it here. As you can, I hope you can see. It is a bit slow because it's a double connection, but we can manage. So this is the subset of the area of Alba Fusions that we analyzed for the case study. And then we can do we can perform the Prisma L2 bands evaluation. So if you are going to click here, you can see that here we can put the input file name. So we put here the subset that we have just created. Here you can, if you want to reduce again the area, you can put a map boundary, or otherwise you can leave it white so that it will take all the image. And then here you can put the output file name, which is a txt file that you can open from in Excel, for example, and I already did this. So you have in the first column the number of the band. In the second column, you will have how many node data are associated to each band. Maybe I can show you also the raw files that we obtain, which is this one, before putting it in Excel. This is the raw file, so you can see the double columns separated by a comma. In the first column, you have the number of the band and the how many nodata each band has in the second column. So you can import this txt file in Excel, as I already told you, and you can do some process. For example, we calculated the percentage of the nodata for each bands. And we did this calculating the total number of the pixels inside the image, and then compared how many nodata are, how many nodata, so how many pixel contains nodata in percentage, just to have an information in percentage. So after that, we can come back here. In the software. And we can also, we did a spatial modeler to visualize this, the bad bands. For example, here you can put the number of the bad band. For example, we obtained that the bad number two contains no data. So it is a bad band, like the number three or four. So we can also go into visualize this in this spatial modeler. Here you can see the number two, but we can also put number three, for example. And you can see the red points are the ones, the pixel that contain no data. So you see that in this image, there are a lot of no data. Okay. So can you hear me?
Yes, yes, all okay.
Perfect. So after that, we can go to raster and to the hyperspectral analysis workstation. I already opened it here. This is how it is presented. At first, from file and open image analysis, you can click and open the image. I already opened it. And you can edit the sensor information, as I explained before. So here you can load a txt file that I show you. Sensor information. Okay. It is made by the number of bands, and it contains the wavelength corresponding to each band and the bandwidth. So you are going to input this file inside the software so that, as you can see, each band is associated to the correct wavelength. And here we can see the plot, the corrected plot with the corrected wavelength for this sensor, for the Prisma sensor. After that, we can apply, we can insert the bad band information. So from the txt files, txt file that we have created, we are going to see which band is a bad band. And we are going to check, this, this column here. I already did this, so I put from number 1 to 16 as bad bands, and you can see the red stripes here in the first part of the graph, and so on. So each bad band that you found in the txt file, you can check and say that it is a bad band. Maybe I can open more. Okay, so you can also see the relative image with the relative histogram by clicking in the second column. Now you can visualize the first bands, but we can also go to the second or to the sixth and see that the graph continues staying not regular and uniform. Okay, so this is not delayed physically, the bad bands, but only virtually. If you want to see the image without the bad bands, so applying the spectral subset, you can go to view and to preprocess and click on bad bands. And then you can see in the screen, you can visualize the image without the bad bands. As I already told you, you can also apply the spectral subset or the spatial subset, but as we already did before, now it's not applied, it's not performed. If you want to see directly here from here a spectral signature, you can also check this target here. For example, if you want to understand, if you want to plot the spectral signature of a street like here, you can click, and here you directly see the spectral signature of the street. You can see the windows of the atmospheric absorption, and you can see that in the gray stripes, you don't see the spectral signature because we classify them like bad bands. After that, if we want to compare this spectral signature with the ones presented in the spectral libraries. Here there are four kind of libraries. I don't open it, otherwise the connection crashes. I already know that, but here there are the ASTER, the USGS, in which you can check, you can take the spectral library's signature, and then you can compare the materials, the already known materials, with the unknown spectral signature. Otherwise, you can do this also in Excel. For example, we did this in Excel by making a right click. 3 minutes. Yes, I almost finished. And you can click on inquire cursor. It takes a while. Okay, so here you can see the cursor that you can move in where you want to check the spectral signature. For example, here. And the reflectance values are these ones, the file pixel values, and you can select and export in a file Excel as we did. And I show you directly the result. Maybe I already opened it. Yes, okay. So you can put the number of bands, the respective wavelength, and then we make the analysis in the alpha fusions for the pits, rock, dark soil, light soil, and alpha fusion soils with the reflectance values. And you can put it inside the graphs to make all the analysis and the process. I think I finished. Let me see if I lost something, but I think no. Okay, yes, I finished. I hope it was interesting, and we are open to questions.